Hello, everyone. Welcome to today's train-to-trainer session on the new DASA DevOps Product Owner course. My name is Alexander Mazurek, and I'm going to help moderate today for our presenter, Eddie Hausman. He's going to be covering the six modules of the Product Owner training. Just something for you all to know, at the end of each module, we're just going to take a time to see if there were any questions asked. There should be a questions panel either on the right side or bottom side of your screen, depending on which platform that you are using. At any point, just feel free to ask a question during any point during the module, and then we'll take a look at the questions at the end of the module and answer them for you. So there'll be six portions during this train-to-trainer in which we will be stopping to answer questions, so feel free to do so. With that said, we'll go ahead and jump right in. I'm going to hand things over today to our presenter, Eddie Hausman, and he is one of the co-developers of the course, and here he is.
Well, welcome everybody to the webinar. Hopefully you can all hear me well. Looking forward to telling you lots of things about this very exciting new training. So well, let's just dive right in immediately and give you, for starters, some background. What you see is that this is now one of the parts of the DASA program. This was one of the first ones that had actually been developed, as you can see on here. Today we will be focusing specifically on the DASA DevOps Product Owner training. So what you see here also is that this fits in very nicely within the way that we look at DevOps teams from DASA. You'll see that there's a specific people in, and of course one of the most important people, one of the most exciting roles in a DevOps and Agile team is of course the role of the product owner. You see a couple of different profiles in the team too, and DASA will provide everyone with specific training for all of these types of profiles and people in a DevOps team. Again, today we are talking about the product owner. What does a general product owner look like? Well, you see that on this slide. And of course, this is very general. It says something about 3 to 5 years of work experience. I know very professional product owners that have been doing this for half a year. I also know a couple of people that have been doing this for 10 years and probably will never learn how to do it. But of course, this is more generic. Some of the other things that are important: understanding the software development life cycle, especially when of course, working in IT, which a DevOps product owner would be, being analytical, experience working on the intersection between business and IT, being a leader, not too much, of course, as a Scrum team, an Agile team, a DevOps team is, of course, a autonomous cross-functional team, but at least someone that knows how to work with a team and, know how to get the best out of them, create the best value possible for the client. Slightly impatient, which is, can be difficult sometimes for the team, but it's something that a product owner also needs, and definitely needs a mandate from the business to be able to prioritize. So just a generic look at what a DevOps product owner, what kind of person that would be. Well, let's go to the first module. As Alex already said, we have six modules, which we kind of structured around the role of the product owner and also about value, which you will see later. And the first one is the context of the product owner. Why do we actually have product owners? Where did all this come from? And for people that have been working with us before, you will probably see a couple of familiar slides. We have been very inspired by some of the previous material that we created, especially the Agile Foundation and also the, say, the Scrum product owner training that we created. So some of the material we actually reused and made it a little bit more in line with all the subject we're talking about, the DevOps product owner. So every slide, and I'm not going to go through all of these now with you, but at least so you know, every module will start with specific objectives for the module, which of course as a trainer can be very useful because at the end of the module, you can actually check with your audience, with the students, if they have been able to learn all these things. And if not, go back to some of these specific topics and give them some more info about it. What you will see as module objectives for this specific model is that they're pretty much generic on Agile, on the differences and similarities between Agile, Lean, and DevOps, and also some of the tools that we are using in all three of these. So the specific module topics for this module are what is a product owner, do a little Agile introduction, an overview on Scrum, and then also the relationship between Agile, Lean, and DevOps. So a product owner. Who is a product owner? What kind of role is this? Well, a product owner is in general very much responsible for delivering value. So a product owner is not just someone who works with products, but also with anything that can actually create value. So it might be kind of services, can be groups of products, but it's just a name that has been chosen at this moment. I do know that in the Agile community at this moment, there's a lot of discussion about it. Should we start calling it a product or a value owner? But well, for now, it's a product owner. You, in this role, represent all stakeholders, so not just clients or customers, but anyone involved with the product or service you create. Is the sole person managing the product backlog, of course, with some assistance from the team, but is at least the sole person responsible for the product backlog, also responsible for the ROI, the return on investment, how much effort and money and time do we put into something and what will we actually get back value-wise, and then, of course, also the person that defines the scope, vision, roadmap, and specifically for a DevOps product owner in a mix between development and operations work, so anything that any work that belongs to the product or the service, the product owner is responsible for. Product owner, well, works in a context. And of course, traditionally, when we just started working in Scrum, you saw that most product owners were, well, only involved with, well, new things, development work, creating very nice products for customers, and only, well, being very much busy with the team in creating those kind of things. And now with DevOps, of course, looking at the whole life cycle of a product or a service, you see that changing. You see that, well, your definition of done definitely gets bigger. You're responsible for way more material and activities within the team, and we'll definitely see that in the training of today. So the key characteristic, though, of a product owner is that they work in an agile environment, so with agile teams. Well, what is agile? And most of you will probably already have seen this or know this, but let's just show you how we will actually approach this in this specific training. What we want to do before we start diving into all kinds of details in the training, with the team, we do a little exercise and have them write down in words what Agile is. And this will as a trainer, also give you a very good idea about your audience. What I sometimes also do is I ask them to give them a number from 1 to 5 on their experience. So at least when you start, you have a good understanding about how many experts you have in the team and how many people you actually still have to, well, give a lot of details in your training. And that might really help at the beginning, which is also why we put this exercise at the start. Well, this, of course, you know, and this is just one of the reasons why customers are doing Agile and working with Agile. To tell you also in advance, I'm not going to go over all the slides. I will go over the things that I think that need some explanation. Of course, you will find a lot of extra information on the notes sections of the PowerPoint presentation, which will give you more understanding. And if there's specific slides that I skip and you have questions about, as Alex said, we can answer those after each module. Well, this you also might have seen before. This is a basic slide on what are the differences between traditional versus Agile. There's a lot of material on this available. This is the material that we use. And it's also always good to create some understanding about what the differences are, but not good to go into some sort of like waterfall bashing mode. Anything that we did in the past was wrong, but really put it on the positive side and say, well, now we're really looking into this way of working and it has got all these advantages versus what we had in traditional development. You can probably find your own way of explaining this in a way that fits with your training style and the customer that you're working with. The Agile Manifesto. Well, I hopefully don't need a lot of explanation on this. Let's hope that you've all seen this. Not all of your students may have seen this, even if they are product owners. So it's good to give them a little bit of understanding and explanation on this. And what I always tend to say as a trainer is that if you remember one thing about Agile, remember this. This is the most important part. This is the basis of everything that we are talking about today. These 12 Agile principles are actually, underneath the four you saw on the previous slide. So I always tell them, tell the students, this exists. You need to have read them. You need not understand all of them, especially for the product owner. Some of them might be very technical, very software based. So they need to understand that it's not just the four principles, but these 12 are underneath those. A little Scrum overview. Sometimes I get the question, what's the big difference between Agile and Scrum? And for me, always the easiest thing to say is, you are Agile and you do Scrum. Scrum is just one of the frameworks, one of the methods that you can use to implement Agile at your customer. And well, this is the Quint diagram that we use in all our trainings, and something that you should be able to actually explain to your students. So you should be able to go over this full scheme, this whole framework, and explain to people what the different parts are. You can go over them pretty quickly because most of them, especially the ones that are involved with the work of a product owner, will of course be handled and explained in more detail in later modules. So we're not going to go over it for now. What we do then to do is, because sometimes the module or the framework, the diagram is a little bit overwhelming. So we tend to say sometimes, well, you know, look at it like this. There's 10 very important things in there. There's like three Scrum artifacts. So say products, the product backlog, the sprint backlog, and the dashboard. There is four events, the daily stand-up, the sprint planning, the sprint review, and the retrospective. And then there's the three roles, which of course, the most important one for this training is the product owner role. So it's 10 things that you really need to be knowing a lot about, as you can see here. And then of course, there's things like refinement and definitions of done, which are also important. These are really the ones that will have to be covered in a generic Scrum training. Then of course, the Scrum team itself. And very important to start the training with always is, and you see that here also, explaining that the product owner is definitely part of the Scrum team. So within the Scrum team, we have the development team, but within the Scrum team, the three roles are all important. There's no hierarchical situation in the team. No one is the boss of anyone else, but it's very important to mention time and time again that the product owner is part of the Scrum team. The product owner spends any time they are not with their stakeholders with the Scrum team. And well, you see here that of course this team is self-organizing, cross-functional, and has a lot of freedom in how they actually create the solution, create value for the customer. Okay, a little bit on the relationship between Agile, Lean, and DevOps, because you might get a lot of questions about that. Well, we try to create some simple slides, and this is one of the slides where you actually see that we're still working on some of the material. The material is all not finished. We will make sure that we share, of course, the finished material with you when it is. But well, this shows you that, well, the lean way, of course, is a big basis on everything that we are talking about. It's a basis on lean IT, on the different agile methodologies, and specifically also on DevOps. And then if you look at this in a more graphical way, well, what you see happening in the differences between Agile and DevOps is that specifically when a team that used to be working on development and created a great product at a certain moment really does not want to have another department in the company doing all their operations work, fixing their work, fixing their bugs, looking at all the incidents that any development work has created. They want to do it themselves. So at a certain moment, they start picking up these kinds of tasks and duties also. And at a very natural way, they will start becoming, from an Agile team, a DevOps team. Well, this is also a very nice moment to start asking questions to the students group about what is DevOps, a little bit similar to what we did earlier with Agile. So answer the question with single words, and it will give you a nice overview on what people actually note and will say when you ask them the question, what is DevOps? Gives you a nice understanding on about what they already know, and that will help you definitely in other modules also. So a very nice small exercise which could probably take 5 or maybe 10 minutes. Well, some DevOps definitions, because of course you also you always have people in the group that like that and need that. Of course, there's plenty more to find. If you Google DevOps, you will find hundreds of them. It's just a couple that we want to show because they are, well, some of the most generic ones. It's not a thing. It's always the combination between development and operations. It's a culture. So all these kind of things you see happening here. And of course, well, the DevOps movement makes it very specific, but also very vague sometimes to say what DevOps is. So it's really nice to be able to discuss this with your group of students at the beginning of the training. Well, why do we actually want to merge development and operations? Well, you see a couple of very nice reasons here based on some of the problems that have been existing in companies. Again, also a very well, nice basis to have some discussion on this. This is, of course, not a DevOps Foundation training. Hopefully, some of the people that you will get in the training will have been following the training, maybe even are certified, have their certification. Well, here you again see the six DevOps core principles as we always use them and as DASA does. You can give some explanation on what this actually means. It will also help you explaining this in explaining some of the differences between a traditional product owner and a DevOps product owner. The team, very important. What you see here also is that the team might be a development or a DevOps team, but still some of the duties that are in there are very similar. Typically a team of 3 to 9 people, as you hopefully know, is there's some proof that when teams get bigger, they start splitting up in smaller teams and they start missing a lot of focus. Self-organizing, cross-functional, works on both development operations work, specifically for this training, of course, very important to mention this. And they maximize focus on creating predictability and velocity. So, as you see, this module is really based on some general starters info to get you started with your group of students. Key characteristics of a DevOps team. Well, you see that here. Most of the things that any team is doing, but then a lot of specific things on differences between a, say, development and a DevOps team. And also already a mentioning at the bottom that a product owner in a team like this must be able to facilitate all these different kinds of actions and tasks. And that is the most important part of this training. Then of course, when a team is not fully able to be working autonomously, well, how do you actually get these people working together? And we'll see some examples of this also later on in other modules, but working on the same system, dependencies. Well, then of course, it also means that it's not enough to be a great product owner for your own team, but also be able to cooperate with the product owners of the other teams and knowing what is going on. So, and then it's also stating here, the concept of coordinating DevOps teams is referred to as scaling. And scaling agile and scaling DevOps will also be part of this training in later modules. Okay, well, what you also see is that at the end of any module, we will have a little team discussion. So we had some discussions on certain topics, but then also what we did is in every module, you'll see a slide for a little team discussion. And also, as you can see, some module end questions. Just some examples of the kind of questions that the students might get in the exam after they successfully finished your 2 day of training. So, which actually finishes off our module one training. So we're now going into some more specifics of the role of the product owner. So at the end, again, use the module objectives at the end of the module. Someone should be able to actually, well, explain to anyone what a product owner does, what the role is, what the main competencies are, and also what you actually do in practice. So the role, the competencies, and a product owner in practice. Well, here's a couple of quotes on what a product owner does. Also in relation to Scrum Masters, others. This is really, well, something that you could use. If you have other quotes in your other training material that you want to add, please do so. This is just to get, say, the discussion flowing on the role of the product owner. And it's always funny to hear that people have different opinions, but in the basis, they're always talking about the same thing. It's someone that is talking to business, talking to customers, talking to stakeholders, has a single point of contact kind of role for the team, is feeling very responsible for the product and the value that's being delivered. So it's always good to use these kind of slides. Of course, the role of the product owner has really evolved. If you look at what the role used to be in a waterfall environment, it was more like a senior user, project manager, sometimes service managers. And then, of course, Scrum started happening and we were really focused on development. And now you see that they're also sharing that focus with development and operations work. So customer value has become more important. It used to be a lot of planning. It's now more customer value. And then, of course, one of the, well, core reasons to have a product owner is to maximize that value to the customer, have a person speaking to that customer all the time. And then also understanding that the product owner is responsible for all the value, so anything that's being delivered by the team. How do you actually become a product owner? What kind of roles have we been seeing becoming a product owner in the past? Well, of course, project managers, business analysts, senior business analysts, information managers, and senior development team members, of course, sometimes also became a product owner. People from sales also, anyone that is really able to be able to do this and has a background in projects analysis can become a great product owner. Very important is that these people have actually product knowledge mandate and is available. And this combination is key to being successful as a product owner. What you also see happening now is that teams around product owners are being created, sometimes virtual teams, and you also see these kind of roles in there, like project managers helping coordinating things, business analysts and information analysts looking at anything that helps the product owner refining their stories. Those kind of things is what you see happening now. Very natural evolution of the role. Well, this movie, hopefully you have already seen it. We put it in the slides to be able to show it to your students. It's 15 minutes, so it's a bit long, but it's very, very helpful in understanding the role of the product owner. Hey, it's also called Agile Product Ownership in a nutshell. As you hopefully know, that any movie that you can find by Hendrik Nieberg is always a very valuable movie. He's made a lot of more things that you can actually look at. He's now very busy with the environment. But this specific movie is one that that I personally use a lot in training, and we also chose to put it in here to start this module with a good understanding about the role of the product owner, what's important to them, what's not, what's being expected of them, what kind of dependencies are there with the other roles. So all those kind of things are in this movie. So I would suggest that you actually show it to your students. Here's more detail on the roles and responsibilities of the product owner, which we have seen a little bit before. Represent the stakeholders, looking at product development, also working on releases, monitor the use of the product. Sometimes it's also important to not just look at your client, but also the clients of your client. If that's a thing, then that will also be part of the role of the product owner to look at that. As we said before, also looking at the return on investment and, of course, the product backlog. What you see here is more or less an overview on all things that are roles and responsibilities of the product owner. As I've said before, a product owner needs to be empowered, qualified, and available. That's where it all starts. But then, of course, looking at customer needs, create your product vision, create a ready backlog. So any work that's on the backlog, especially the work that's on the backlog on top, needs to be ready for the team to start working on immediately. Looking at the different product owner styles, helping the team to do the right things or helping the team to do things right. Of course, both are important. And then also helping them with refining user stories, prioritizing, explaining what a customer really wants, how is the product going to be used. So giving a lot of detail, working with the team on creating the best value for a customer. The competencies of the product owner. And what you will see here is some of the DASA competence framework diagrams. And you will actually notice that this is a very broad role. A lot of the different aspects that are in this framework, they do fit very nicely with the work of the product owner. And specifically the the next slide, you will see also that a product owner has a lot of different knowledge areas at expert level. So this is a difficult role. It's a very challenging role. It's a fun role. But if you look at all the competencies, then this is really a role for people that are able to work on expert level on a lot of different areas. Also here, being a leader. I mean, not the boss of the team. That's not the idea about Scrum and Agile and DevOps. But really being able to act as a leader, take leadership on anything that's happening in the team. If things go wrong, hop in. You're not saying, I have to talk to the customer now. I cannot help you. No, really be part of the team. Be a servant leader, just as a Scrum Master should be, working together with the Scrum Master, with the team, doing lots of things on explaining what the customer wants, but also feeling involved in continuous improvement, visit the retrospective sessions, all those kind of things are extremely important. And of course, courage, one of the Scrum values, which really fits in nicely with the work of a product owner. Now, what you also see here on this slide is for some of the specific events in Scrum, what is a product owner doing there? So this will help you in discussing with your students on, the role of the product owner in, for instance, the daily stand-up, in the retrospectives, all those kind of things. It's extremely important. We have mentioned this before. If the product owner is part of the team, and he or she is, definitely, then also have a role in all the different kinds of meetings. Of course, the daily stand-up is really something for the development team, but if you have the time, go there, visit the team, be with them, answer questions, all those kind of things. Very important. Availability of a product owner for the team is extremely important, and we cannot mention that enough. Also, in decomposing the product vision, a vision can be very broad and can be very vague to people in a team, especially if they're technical people. So find a way working with the team to actually decompose that product vision towards something that can go to the customer and the team can actually feel in line with, so that they actually will understand how they can deliver that value to the customer, sometimes in the form of a minimum viable or marketable product, and go from product vision to actually delivering customer value to the customer. And we'll talk a little bit more on the product vision and on value later in other modules. The daily stand-up is extremely important for the team and can, of course, really be used by the product owner to find out what's happening. So I probably don't have to explain to you what daily stand-up is for. You see that here. Most of the most important things here are finding out how this team can help each other and where they see some impediments, some blockages which will not help them get their work done. So as a product owner, it can be important to actually know about these things. So as I said before, visit the team, go work with the team on the daily stand-up when possible also. Sprint planning session, it's about the what and the how. And of course, as a product owner, you are mostly responsible on the what, and you give the responsibility on the how to the development team. What you see in this little scheme here is a product backlog going to a sprint backlog, which is being split up in tasks. And of course, the estimation part. This is really where you can shine as a product owner. You can really help the team working with them on getting the sprint planned as optimal as possible. Get as much work in there that can actually be achieved. Look at the sprint goal and see that that's the most important thing, and make sure that you and the team deliver anything that you actually promised to the customer and even committed to. Of course, this is really your moment. If you look at all the different events in Scrum, this is the one that you are really being able to talk to your customer, to take the whole journey from the product vision, the ideas of the customer, to actually delivering value, do a great demo with the team, have the team also tell the customer about what they have been doing. And then, of course, make the changes that need to be made to the product backlog, deliver some value, and make sure that this is the most optimal meeting that you can have, because sometimes this might be the only moment that you really get the time to talk to your stakeholders and to your customers. the sprint retrospective, more about the process than about the product, of course. And this is really important to, well, pick your role in the team and make sure that when you talk about continuous improvement of the team, the way they work together, the processes they use, also how the culture is in the team, what the culture is in the team, how they work together. Well, make sure that you visit this also. Make sure that they will feel that the product owner is part of the team and has the discussion with the complete team on all these kind of things. And very important, and you see that at the bottom of the slide, make sure that any activities that come out of this are also being added to the next sprint. And yes, this will take up some of the time of the team. And that will be time that is not, able to do work for the customer. But of course, it's extremely important that this is still done, because in the long run, it will definitely help the team get better, and it will make you able to deliver better quality value to your customer. What we also did is we made a sort of like a week schedule as an example, because some people have some difficulties on understanding what a product owner does in a complete week. Nah, and that's what you see here. So it's just an example. And of course, again, this is also very nice to do some discussion on this. Maybe some people have been working with specific product owners. Some of them are product owners. So it's good to see if they feel that this is a realistic schedule of a week. And have a very nice discussion with them on this. So you see all the different events, you see all the work, you see them meeting a lot of stakeholders, of course, also just calling them, finding out if things are still okay. All those kind of things. Visiting the daily standard. Well, anything that you can imagine that a product owner does is on here also. Yeah, and we put the Saturday and the Sunday optional because we do know that some of the product owners are actually working in the weekend. Again, at the end of the module, some questions to actually check if your students have been listening to you, have been understanding everything. And of course, you will know all the answers already, but we will provide you with the right answers so that that you can mention those to the students also. So this ends our second module. I think everyone understands that you cannot do a training like this without repeating some of the basic material that we already have available. So you might get some comments on that. Remember, if you get comments from product owners about a product owner exam, about 30 to 40% of the questions will actually be about the Scrum framework. So there might be very detailed questions about understanding what the Scrum framework is, also in this exam. So there's also always something that you can use explaining why there's still so many things mentioned about the Scrum framework itself. Okay, well, the module objectives for this specific module are, because it's about value, describing the importance of value, some key aspects on that, some product vision techniques that are now being used in agile environment, and also the relationship between user stories, epics, and features. Okay. What we did in the next modules, we actually created four around value. So we start actually with the first one, which is called envisioning, and then we go to maximizing, translating, and delivering, just to create some kind of structure around value, which of course is one of the most important subjects for a product owner. So the topics, value of the product, envisioning the product, and also decomposing the vision. Well, value. This is of course one of the most talked about subjects in the agile world. What is business value? And anyone that gives you a piece of paper that says, well, this is always business value for a customer, well, of course, never believe those people. Business value for any stakeholder or any customer is of course very much different. Which also means that for a product owner, finding out what the real business and customer value is for a customer is extremely important. See a couple of examples on this slide. This is something that you that can again use as a nice discussion. Maybe have people giving some examples on where they actually made the mistake of thinking that they were delivering value and they weren't. So again, this is one of those slides that you can really use for those kind of things. If you look at value, you see a couple of examples here, key value areas, current value, time to market, ability to innovate, those kind of things you can look at if you are an agile organization and find out which of those the customer, the stakeholders find the most important ones. And if you go to like the business value in the eye of the beholder, it's better to look at the next slide, because there you see some of the differences. If you are a hotel owner or a potential guest of a hotel, just as an example, and of course we can think of about 10 or even more other examples, you see that business value and customer value can be different. You see a couple of nice examples on this, which again can be used in your discussions with the team. So you give them some examples, you have them give you some examples. So nice discussion, I guess. So more on business value, some sources, which you probably recognize, just to give people more understanding that value is a very broad subject. There's a lot of different things that can be part of value, which you see on here. So of course, risk is also very important, looking at value, especially risk reduction. And also looking forward to the future, capability building, those kind of things. What do we put in our processes to create better value? Another slide that shows this a little bit more and actually links business values to structure is this one. And this is a very interesting one, because what this actually shows is value streams. And of course, we already had value streams in Lean. We are talking about value streams in agile training. What you see this happening with your customers more and more. Customers that start working with SAFe or maybe with less, where with SAFe they're talking about agile release trains, with less they talk about areas. You see a lot of customers at this moment, a lot of organizations, especially big organizations, struggling with how do I actually pick the right value streams for my company. Is it based on the products I have? Is it based on client groups? Well, so it's nice to show this to people too, because as a product owner, you will definitely play a big role in this. Some companies are actually now looking for different kinds of product owners, because they divided their whole structure into value streams. And you get value stream owners, you get product managers that work with product owners in teams. So it's good. It's good to to tell your audience, tell your students about some of the things that are happening with this at this moment in big companies. Envisioning the product. So we're going into the product vision a little bit more now. See that here? The product owner tools, well, at least the most important tools, the vision, the roadmap, and the product backlog. So if you go back to the standard Scrum diagram, the picture of the framework, you can see exactly where this product vision subject is most importantly. It's at the beginning of the process, when the customer has given us some needs, or maybe just a problem that we need to solve for them, talks with business picks a product owner, and then, the product owner starts envisioning this product, starts talking to the customer, other stakeholders, and with maybe some workshops on persona scenarios, use cases, writing down lots of user stories, tries visualizing this product vision into something that can be useful and that can be worked with the team. And of course, one of the most important tools there is the first product backlog, and then after that, product backlog managing to start from a division creating value for the customer. And here's some examples of what an effective product vision is. Well, of course, the customer needs to be in there. And also very important that a product vision is not something that a product owner keeps to himself. It's very important as a guide for the team. Sometimes the vision will not immediately will be the source of a lot of activities and tasks for the team, but it gives them a direction. They all will also see the dot on the horizon. Where are we going with this product? How can I actually be of help from the team? I might be just a programmer or a tester, but I will definitely be part of the solution to the customer in the future. So also something nice that can of course also be used in the exam is just a couple of words that are good to remember. And one of the nice things that I do with this slide at the end of or at this moment in the training is use the last one. So do a elevator test, an elevator pitch. So have some people think of a product that they really like, and then have them do an elevator pitch on the product to all the other people in the audience, all the other students, to have them practice a little bit about how difficult it can sometimes be to be asked to tell you why you are, tell anyone why you are enthusiastic about something in just a minute or maybe 2 minutes. It's a really nice exercise to do. What you see here is a very, it's almost like a hidden word. Because if you look at the aspects of what a compelling product vision is, simple, unexpected, concrete, credible, emotional, you will actually see that it spells the word success, although it's spelled wrong because it should actually end with two S's. But it's nice to be able to use these acronyms to remember some of the aspects of a product vision. So you will actually also be able to give them the tip that some of these will be used in the exam, because sometimes you might get questions about what is simple in a product vision, or how concrete does it need to be. So the acronym SUCCESS will actually help them to remember these different aspects. Well, some of the techniques that are being used are personas and scenarios, use cases and user stories. And this is the kind of slide where I always say, you use this for in your own way, use this in your own style. If you really like to work with workshops on personas, use that. If you really want to go and have them work on user stories already and explain it to them, do that. It's not prescribed how you actually need to do this. So make this your own slide. Make this something that you can actually work with. This is one that I would always use. Although you can explain that this is actually not from the Scrum guy, but really from all kinds of programming methodologies that were there even before Scrum. But do explain, especially to product owners, that this can be very useful for two very important purposes. If you use this for all the user stories, you can actually compare them to each other. You can do relative planning and relative estimation, but also make sure that they understand that the team writes all their work down in this way, and the user role is actually the customer. Because if you find out that they're doing a lot of work that they're not really doing for the customer, well, maybe you should start a discussion with them that they should stop doing that work. So a very important one, which you have probably already seen before. Well, some of the techniques that you can use for product vision, and again, a very nice acronym again, INVEST. They need to be independent, negotiable, valuable, estimable, small, and testable. And on the small part, you can sometimes expect some of the exam questions again. Negotiable is sometimes something difficult that's something that people will not immediately understand. It's really about you should be able to discuss on product vision and also on the user stories to make them as specific as possible. So they need to be negotiable. They should not be vague. You should be able to actually explain them. Activity time. Well, at this moment in time, you did a couple of discussions with the students, but not really a real exercise. Well, this one is. What we normally do here is have them think of a new product. And it could be a product that they could use on their own, in their own organization, or just something completely new, an application, a new product. And then split up your group in teams and have them create a product vision statement, maybe even a pitch. Make them do it in any form they like. Sometimes sometimes teams come with their own PowerPoint slides, but sometimes they come up with very new techniques to do it. And make sure that if you have a couple of teams in your audience, that they actually present it to each other. And then also make sure that you you spend some time on feedback, giving feedback from teams, also giving feedback yourselves. Make some jokes about how great their product is and you actually want to start selling it and start your own company tomorrow. You know, those kind of things are very, this is really a fun activity. And you'll see that in half an hour time, a group of people that don't know each other can come up with very, very creative ideas, which are always a lot of fun during these kind of training sessions. Okay. Decomposing the vision. What you see here is an example, and I stated this very specifically, an example of a product vision board. As you hopefully know, in the agile world, in the DevOps world, it's almost like we're all working in open source and public domain. Anything that you think of has already been invented somewhere else, and it's all available on the web. So this one I specifically like using as an example because it's pretty extensive. It's by Roman Pichler. I always say to my groups of students that any book that this guy writes on business value is like, well, the kind of book that you want to read when you're a great product owner. So it's a useful example to explain to product owners that there's a lot of tools available that can help them. But of course, they have to pick their own tool. What I do state sometimes is that if they work together with other product owners in a company on one product, it's probably a good idea to all start using the same tool. Sometimes when there's time, I use this as an exercise also. They just created their own product in the previous exercise. So let them fill out this board, looking at the product that they created, well, to have them work on decomposing the product vision towards more specific parts of their work. So what kind of needs am I answering to with this product? What do I think the revenue streams are going to be? So those kind of things can be fun to actually practice with your students. Well, what you see on this slide is also fun to discuss because this is actually a product backlog, but then completely created in a diagram way to make them understand that any work with a high return on investment will of course be done first, but then the world starts happening again, and the next day you get a call by your customer and he comes up with new information, suddenly needs things that he thought or she they would maybe need in 6 months time. You know, that whole process, that whole product management process, that whole product backlog management process, well, you see happening here on this slide. And of course, it also leads to a discussion sometimes that a customer has, well, giving you a lot of information about what they needed, and you wrote them all down in user stories, and you get into a discussion at a certain moment that the return on investment of these items is actually negative. It's more or less like nice to have. They will have to put more energy and time and money in there, and it will not give them a lot of value. And that's the moment that you actually start having a discussion with your customer on, well, just ending the project. The product is complete now. It's not exactly what we thought of 3 months ago, but now we're using it in real life. We actually see that this is enough and we don't want to spend more money on it. So you actually use business value and return on investment to make strategic decisions. And this is just a diagram that shows that in a graphical way. Which also brings us to the subject of a minimal viable product. The first product that you are actually delivering as a DevOps team, a Scrum team, an Agile team, is a product that your customer can give you feedback on. And a minimal viable product is, say, the minimal product that you will have to create to be able to actually receive feedback. And of course, this is different for every team, for every customer. So this is really something that the product owner needs to discuss with their customer. Is this just a pile of documents? Is it a design? Is it a prototype? Is it a mock-up of an application? Is it a mock-up of a GUI, of a website? Those kind of things you need to discuss with your customer. And it's really one of the items that you need the most in decomposing your product vision towards value, because this will be a in-between step maybe to the kind of value that the customer wants at the end. So you see that here also, you have your product vision board. You could use the one that we showed before, but maybe another visualization. From that, you create your first product backlog. You start creating minimal viable products. You start creating products. You get feedback from the users, from the customers, and you make the changes. And you do that until the customer says, well, this program is done, or this project is done now, this product is done now, or you just keep on continuing throughout the whole life cycle. So the minimal viable product is pretty, well, important in this process. And then, of course, there are epics, features, and user stories. Always nice to have a great discussion in your students' team. I always explain this in the way that you need to have some characteristics to be able to go from huge piles of work, big themes, just things that companies start working about. It might be strategic themes that they work on, even also from a strategic vision, towards work that can actually be done by an agile team or a DevOps team. So, this is one of the ways of working that has been adopted in the agile DevOps world a lot. So I would guess 95% of the teams I know actually use this. And we have provided you with a couple of examples again on a hotel. So to explain that there's a vision, the vision creates epics. From these epics, you get specific features, and the features all have their own user stories. And you will see that in examples in the next couple of slides. So you see some more explanation on this here also. Sometimes people like to think in time frames, and then I would say very broadly, an epic could be like a year of work, a feature maybe a quarter of a year, and a user story is the amount of work that actually fits in a sprint, in an iteration. That will help people understand the difference in detail between these words. Slicing and dicing, also very important. If you look at the previous slide, you need to find a way to get from your epics to your user stories. These are just a couple of reasons why you would actually slice. Of course, if it's too big, if the story is too large to estimate, you find out during planning poker that, we always get to a score of 100. We definitely need to split. Just a couple of examples why you want to slice a story. Also important to mention there is that there's two big reasons why you actually want to do it. And it's not always value. Sometimes cutting up a user story will actually help you to reduce risk. Creating the first part of a user story first, then receive feedback, might help you in understanding better what the customer wants. So it will actually be less risky than just creating the whole thing immediately and then finding out you have to start all over again. So value and risk are the most important perspectives that you can choose if you want to have a discussion on slicing and dicing. And then what you see is that if you decompose the product vision, you can also practice that. We have given the students a lot of information on this subject, and now of course is the time, and we take another 30 minutes for this, to actually start decomposing the vision that they created before on a new product or a new application. And we say, you create epics, create user stories. Normally we leave out the features. So you see here that there's not an amount mentioned. This is really looking at your time for the day, how much time you actually give them for this. So sometimes you have them create two epics with three user stories, but also have them use the format that we saw earlier, the SI, I can show that format, because it will help them get used to working with that format in the future also, if they are not using it already. So a very nice exercise. Also nice that there will be some structure in the training. They did an exercise on creating a product, creating a product vision, and now they actually start working with that product continue decomposing their vision into a way to get to value for the customer. As you see, we're at the end of this module also. A couple of questions on it, which you can use, of course, again. Value is one of the most important things for a product owner. So let's go into that a little bit. Value. And you see here the structure again, which I think for most students will be a great way to get some grip on all the material. We talked about envisioning value, and now we're talking about maximizing the value. So, very important to be able to maximize value is understanding what value is for your customers. And of course, your customers can be, be the most important stakeholders. So what we're doing here is engaging stakeholders, and also how do we actually influence them. So we're talking a little bit about stakeholder management. This specific part of the training is not really included in the basic product owner training. So it might be a part with added value for some of the product owners that are in your audience. Engaging stakeholders. Okay. Well, this is an example of a process on how to actually manage your stakeholders. So first identifying them, analyzing them, and you already see the stakeholder map there, which we will use later on in the training. Prioritizing them, engaging them, and then of course a lot of communication. And you see the circle happening again. It's almost like a Deming circle, continuing if you have identified the right stakeholders, if you are communicating with them often enough, looking at the right stakeholders, make sure that you talk also with the ones that you think are not that important for your product, all those kind of things. And then also finding ways how to actually interact with your stakeholders. Well, you might have seen this one before. It's just one that we chose to use because it's used a lot in stakeholder training. And it's actually a very simple stakeholder map, where you see that there's two axes on influence and interest, and you see four categories on kinds of stakeholders that you might find in your daily business as a product owner. Some of them you just have to monitor. They are there. They are going not be of a. They don't have a lot of interest in your product. They're not huge influencers. But you need to make sure that they are there, and that they will sometimes come with valuable information. Sometimes the influence is very high, but they're not really interested. It might be something on the risk and compliance part, and you need to keep them satisfied, as you see there. Or the other way around, they have a lot of interest, but they will not give you a lot of influence on the decisions that you make. Well, you need to keep these people informed. Of course, one of the most important groups is the ones that you have to actively engage. Those are the ones that you really need to get to the right kind of value. One of the things that you could use this stakeholder map for, if you want to and if you have the time, is look at the exercise that people have already done on the product vision and user stories, and have them think of what kind of stakeholders they would actually see with this product, and where would these be positioned on the stakeholder map. So if you want to, you can use that as an exercise to make your training a little bit more interactive. Then, of course, if you look at the module, the framework, the diagram that we have been looking at before, it's nice to actually show your product owners, your students, where they are talking to them. And you see that here. You see that especially during refinement, the sprint backlog, you will have a lot of stakeholder touch points, but definitely the most important touch point will be at the demo, at the sprint review, where it will give you all the feedback that you need, sometimes don't want, but definitely can use. So this is just a visualization of where are the moments and the times that stakeholders are actually talking to you in team. Also important to mention is, of course, stakeholders are extremely important and you need them to create value, and you create value for them. But they also have some responsibilities. If you do a sprint review and a demo, and none of your customers or stakeholders are actually visiting, that's of course a chance for them that they missed, because they will have been able to provide you with a lot of feedback, and they didn't. So it's important to also explain to your stakeholders, say for instance you used to be working in a traditional environment, that you're now doing Agile or DevOps, and that you really need them also, that you need their input and their feedback to help your Agile environment grow. And they can play a big role on that. And of course, they have some rights too, because you do a lot of work for them. Well, how do you actually influence your stakeholders? And this is a lot. There's a lot of theory to be found on this on the internet, and we picked just out a couple of examples. How do you influence and persuade? You see a nice fable here, a nice example. This is all again one of those slides where you can have a nice discussion with your group. You can bribe your stakeholders, of course. You can nag. You can coerce. This is a little bit of a negative example. Hopefully, they can also come up with some of the positive things to actually influence and persuade stakeholders. Then again, of course, there's a lot of barriers, a lot of pitfalls that you can find. And you see that we actually found this on the web also. Some obstacles that you can see happening that will not help you in successful persuasion of your stakeholders. So just a list that you can actually mention. Definitely not a complete list. And then, of course, there's also successful persuasion. So what are some of the examples that you have to look at if you want to be successful in actually getting your stakeholders doing what you would like them to do? And you see some good examples on this. And, of course, some of them are, well, very logical, like keeping promises, not arguing, and also understanding how your audience thinks. Things like empathy will, of course, definitely help. Good communication skills. So some of these things are really obvious. But some of them might not be obvious immediately, but they will definitely help in working with your stakeholders. Of course, you can also use some of the traditional tools. If you want to find out what your stakeholder actually wants, well, you see a couple of examples here. Think simple things like interviews and questionnaires, but also brainstorm sessions, requirements workshops. Some of the traditional things that were being used in traditional project management will of course still work here. So let's not look at those as, well, we don't use them because we're now agile. You can definitely still use those in your work with stakeholders. No problem with that. Well, this was not the biggest module in the training. So we're actually already here again at the end. And as we've seen before, just some room for questions here. Well, we talked about value. And now, actually, we go to translating the value into something that the customer can actually use. So, we describe the importance of value, understand the key aspects of getting to value, some product vision techniques in an agile environment, and then, okay, translating. Okay, we go and talk about the backlog and about how we actually estimate work. And there's just a couple of examples that can be used. And as always, these are really examples. I cannot mention this enough. A lot of information can be found on the internet on even more examples than what we actually show you here. The backlog. Okay, well, the product backlog is the most important tool of a product owner. So it's good to spend some time on this. It's the responsibility of the product owner. We already know that. It's a prioritized list. It's emergent, ordered, and estimated. This is like a living document, completely different than the sprint backlog. This document, this list, and it can be any form. It can be an Excel sheet. It can be a Word document. It can be a huge piece of paper on the wall, a brown paper with post-its. It changes all the time. Anytime as a product owner, you get a call from the customer and he or she wants something different. It might be changing, but it is very important to visualize it for the team. Make sure that they do understand where all the information is. It's the single source of requirements. And of course, and now we get to something interesting. If we look at the DevOps product owner, it does not just continue work for new items for the customer, for a new product, new value. It will also contain all other work that the team is doing. And we'll see that later on. So nice to have a discussion with the students about what a product backlog should look like, and then discuss with them, well, especially the one on the left where there's only, say, epics and features, where no team will actually be able to work with those. If I go to a team and say, build me a website, they're going to ask 100 questions to find out how they will actually get from that huge epic to the work that we'll have to be doing. But also the one in the middle where there's just, well, not only too many items, but way too detailed. A lot of these user stories on that product backlog might not have to be done. And we have already spent time refining them, discussing them, maybe even pokering them, estimating them. That's all we want. So what we really want is the one on the right, which is balanced. So very nice, detailed items of work on the top that can be picked up immediately. And some information that will give the team direction towards the future in the form of epics and features. Of course, the definition of done is also extremely important here. It's a document that's sometimes forgotten by teams, but it will definitely give direction. And especially in a DevOps environment, it gets more important. Things like version management, automated build, automated testing, QA environments, all these kind of things are supporting if something is done. And anytime the team has a discussion on is something done or not, well, the definition of done needs to be adjusted and needs to be professionalized towards delivering value that is considered by the customer to actually be done. So at a certain moment, there should not be a lot of discussion, no known remaining work, and work towards a shippable product, as you can see on this slide. Examples of definition of done, you'll see here also. Things like refactoring, the documentation, of course, are all unit tests written and passed. Some things like peer code reviews, all kinds of different things that work well in Agile and DevOps environments that can be considered. What I see happening with very mature Agile teams is that they start with a very small definition of done, then they start adding things, they cluster some of the details on the definition of done, and at the end they have something like 5 or 6 different items on there that really need to be finalized to be able to say, okay, now we have actually created value that's done. Technical debt, also a very, very important item to discuss, coming from software development, of course. Anything that stops happening under pressure will at a certain moment become a real problem. Maybe if you say in sprint one, well, you know what, we skip documentation, we'll have time in sprint two, and then of course the world starts happening again, and well, also in sprint two we don't have time to document, and in sprint 10 we have to talk to the customer, you know what, we have no time to deliver anything new for you, we have to spend our whole sprint on documenting, and you don't want that. So as a product owner, you need to understand this, and you need to find time, plan time, estimate time on the sprint backlog to actually spend time off the team on this, because if you don't, it's really going to hit you at a certain moment. It's going to be a problem and you don't want that. So very important for product owners to understand this, but of course also sometimes a nuisance, because it's not something that you actually want for your customer. You want to create more new nice things for them, and that's not always possible. But indirectly, this will in the long run definitely help you create more value for your customer. The impediment list, extremely important too. Any impediment that is there for the team that blocks them from delivering value needs to be picked up. And of course, as a product owner, you need to be you need to know that this list exists. It's good to sometimes check what's on there, but of course, this is where the Scrum Master plays a more important role, and really should be able to pick this up. But of course, you can work with them, because sometimes you might be able to work with stakeholders, as we've seen before, that can actually take away some of these impediments for the team. Product backlog refinement, a very important set of actions, which is actually a continuous process. Most teams will probably have a refinement session every sprint, but anytime that someone in the team asks the product owner a question on user stories is also refinement. So it's difficult to say how all teams do this. Most will do a refinement session and a sprint planning session afterwards, but the most important thing is to get from a product backlog with very broad work with epics and features on there to a sprint backlog that the the team will actually be able to commit to, which they will feel safe saying, well, you know what, we trust that we will actually be able to do this. We have a sprint goal, we have work, we will actually say we are going to do this for you, dear customer, and that's what you want. So looking at going from the product backlog to a team backlog, it's of course very important if you look at DevOps environments. Say that you are just working with a development team and all the other work, your operations work, is done somewhere else in the company. Well, your product backlog and your sprint backlog are just going to be filled with activities on creating new work. But now in a DevOps environment with a DevOps team, you'll see that there's also incidents on there, lots of activities that are also in line with all the operations work. So it becomes more or less not just a product backlog, but also more or less a team backlog. So any work that the team is doing, all activities that they're doing, all tasks they're doing, should actually be on that backlog so that we can, have a better overview, visualize the activities of the team better, and also do better estimations on that. So it's good to know that, well, you go more or less from the product backlog to the team backlog. And already in the Scrum guide, you see that the mentioning of the backlog is an audit list of everything that is known to be needed in the product. And that definitely, in a DevOps environment, will also be operations work. Knowing that will also mean that if you, for instance, go back to this translating the product backlog to the sprint backlog slide, if you look at the sprint backlog, it will contain way more work than just user stories. So maintenance and refactoring might be in there, maybe very specific documentation. And the product owner must understand that with the capacity that's in the team, this will definitely influence the availability of teams and experts to manage all the work accordingly. So this is where there's a big difference between, say, the traditional development team and a DevOps team. So for a product owner, it's extremely important to understand that this is different and that they might actually be in a situation where they have to learn how to deal with this. What's also used a lot nowadays is the definition of ready, and you see that on here. And this is really used to creating a document that states what criteria a user story needs to have to decide to have the decision by the team to actually put it on the sprint backlog. So it's also agreed by the team, the work is defined and the work is estimated. So that could be something like this, and it's used more and more. Then creating a sprint backlog, you also see some specifics here in the colors where you see the ops work and the DevOps separated. Of course, some of the work will be combined, but some of the work going from a product backlog to sprint backlog, it shows that it's actually, there's different colors used. If you use something like Jira, you could put it in filters or specific labels, but it's good to understand that in our specific example, anything that fulfills all the needs of the definition of ready can go from a product backlog to a sprint backlog if the team feels comfortable with the amount of work. And we'll actually be able, if we look at the Scrum board, to differentiate between the work that's done for dev and DevOps. We've seen this one before. Of course, this still needs to be done also, the sprint planning session. Again, the discussion on what and how, but this is now also different because we know that there's more work to be done than just creating new things. So the what and the how also change. And also in estimating the work, there's more to be done than just creating new things. So the estimation part will also be a little bit different. So how do we actually estimate all the work that the team is doing? Well, just a couple of examples. But before we start with that, let's make sure that everyone understands that this is something that is done by the whole team. It's a team sport, lots of collaboration with the product owner. Story points are preferred, definitely preferred versus ours. We learn from past estimates. You might have heard the some of the examples that we used are like yesterday's weather being used, for instance, in the movie that we saw before. And then, of course, also try to estimate all the operations work when possible. The only thing that makes that difficult is that lots of operations work tends to suddenly appear and in the form of incidents or changes that are suddenly needed. But again, try to reserve some part of the capacity of the team to be able to start doing that work is extremely important. Okay. Now, what kind of estimation techniques are used a lot? And we just picked a couple that are used a lot. There's more on these, which you can probably find on the internet. And maybe some of the students in your team will ask you, well, can I also use this? If you look at the Scrum guide, you will find that there's nothing prescribed there. It does say that a team should be able to estimate their work in sprints or iterations, but it doesn't say anything that you need to use Planning Poker or something like that. So you can also always mention that. Planning Poker is the first one that we have here. You see an example of a Planning Poker deck here. It's loosely based on the Fibonacci calculations. So you see that in the beginning, 1 plus 2 is 3, 2 plus 3 is 5. And we use this to have a broad spectrum of figures, so you can actually get into a discussion with the team. This is really used by looking at every user story that we refined one at a time, and then compare them to each other, have a good discussion on what amount of time we actually think that each and every activity, each and every user story will take. And of course, the most important card in this deck is the coffee deck, as most product owners will probably joke about. So t-shirt sizing is mostly used not on user story level, but mainly used, for instance, on epics and feature level. Just being able to look at big chunks of work and still being able to compare them like we do with t-shirt sizes. So it's not about defining the exact amount of work, but if you have, say, 5 or 6 epics, still being able, they're all epics, they're all big, but some of them are even bigger. And some of those are small ones, and some are the large or extra large ones. And it does avoid discussions about hours. So that might be pretty important. Affinity estimation is something that's like a variation on Planning Poker, where you don't look on or look at one user story at a time, but you actually look at all of the ones that you have refined and you start sorting those stories based on the relative required effort. And then it helps you putting them in buckets, and it gives you an overview on everything that you have already refined, and looking at some of the stories that can be done immediately will definitely fit into the sprint. And also looking at the ones that really still need to be split, sliced and diced. So just some examples on estimation. And as I said, any team needs to look for their own way of estimating which fits with their way of operating. Of course, there's still teams that do estimate in hours. And well, although the Scrum Guide and most Scrum communities will say, don't do it, I do know some very mature teams that are able to do it. The difficulty though is that there's scientific proof that humans cannot really estimate anything more than 8 hours. So it's not preferable. It's preferred to actually use points. But I would suggest that you don't start a discussion with all students in the team if there's someone in there that says, we always plan in hours and it's fine. Well, you know, tell them if it's working, it's working, and that's okay. Well, of course, you're not going to be surprised that in activity time now we're going to do something with estimating. We actually have a fun little exercise, and I want to show you the two slides now. There's something about water distribution just for the trainer, which will of course be pretty easy. You might make a joke about because, well, the students were probably going to telling you that you just want a glass of water or a bottle of water, and well, you can explain to them that you actually just wanted them to turn on the sprinklers. Don't tempt them to do it because they might, but it's good to have the discussion that they have to ask the right questions to get to the ready user story, and also have them ask them how many points, what the relative size would be using, for instance, playing poker cards just for this one. And it will probably give you a half or a one. But then if you go to the next one, it makes it a little bit more difficult. And this is where they actually start understanding that, well, it's a little bit more difficult. Everyone in the building will have to have some water. Now you can do two things. You can split up your group in teams, have them work on this, or you can make it a group discussion, which is also fun. And I think it really depends on the amount of time that you still have. It stays here 30 minutes. I've done this also in a group discussion in 10 minutes. As I say, look at the time, look at where you are in your training, how much time you still have left, and then decide how you want to do this. I think it's pretty logical, and I think it fits very nicely if you look at everything you have explained in the slides before this one, to really check if they have understood what you were saying. So here we have an example of a module summary. We are going to make sure that in each and every module, when everything's finished, you will find these module summaries also, because it will help the students. And some questions, of course, at the end of the module. Delivering value, actually, thinking about value, working with stakeholders, all those kind of things have been done, but now we're actually going to deliver the value to our customer, to our stakeholders. So let's go there. What you see here is the structure again, and now we're at the moment where we are actually going to deliver the value to our customers, to our stakeholders. So how do we monitor progress? Also a little bit about scaling, because yeah, we've been talking about one team, one DevOps team, one Scrum team all the time, and that's with delivery cases. So how do you monitor progress? Well, of course, you use your visual board for this. And again, the Scrum guide, for instance, does not specifically mention how you should do this. It does state that you should be able to visualize this. What is important, though, of course, if we are talking about a DevOps product owner, is that there's more work on the board. And some of this work has, hopefully in the past, already been monitored by the operations team. Some of these reports, KPIs, metrics can, of course, be reused when building visualization for your DevOps team. So that's a good thing. So there's a couple of different ways how to actually monitor the progress of a backlog item. What you want to do, if the team, of course, wants to do that, is look at the backlog items that have been going from the product backlog to the sprint backlog, are on your board, and, well, you can find ways of calculating the progress of these items on the board. This is, of course, something that's managed by the team. This is an example of a burn down chart. You'll also see those with straight lines, but it's a comparison between your ideal line and the actual work, which will give the team an idea about how they can find out during the sprint what their progress is and if they're still on the right track. Kanban boards can be used to really emphasize on the different phases in the process of the team, and will also visualize how the work is actually being pulled from being selected to done. What you don't see on this board is work in progress limits. You could, of course, also explain that to your students if you feel fine about it. If you have a lean background, you will probably know more about Kanban also. It's always nice to tell people, if they don't know where the word Kanban comes from, that it actually means little note of paper, card. So this is really another way of visualization, and it's nice to show, especially for DevOps product owners and DevOps teams, that also the work that does not really fit into a sprint of 2 or 3 or 4 weeks can still be monitored. And Kanban is a great way of actually visualizing that. So here you see an example of the Scrum board with some examples of the reports that can be on there. So you see the product backlog. You see that the user stories have actually been split into tasks. Those kind of things can all be done, but you have to explain to your audience, your students, that this is actually just an example of a Scrum board, because also for this, the Scrum guide and also most DevOps guides will not prescribe what this should look like. The team is really a lot of influence on that. What they want to monitor, they will put on the board. Velocity, as an example, is also something that's being used, of course, by a lot of teams. Well, it can be very useful for them to calculate it, to be able to also have an idea during sprint planning what will fit into the next sprint. And you see an example here that's sometimes used in exams about a discussion on do we actually calculate all the work that we've been doing, or just the work that we have been done, that has been done? Well, you see that difference here, an estimated velocity of 26 and an actual velocity of 18, because we only count all the stories that are really, really done according to the definition of done. Of course, monitoring other items on the team backlog. If we're more into the operations part, so you see some of the operational activities which you could split in recurring and ad hoc. So some of the work you always have to do, well, sometimes you get into a discussion with your team, do we still put it on the board? I would say yes. Make sure the team understands that all the work is on there. So it might be a recurring user story or just an extra card that states all the recurring work. But of course also your ad hoc work, so work that comes in like incidents, needs to be on there. You see that below also, just as a couple of, well, examples on what kind of work will be on the team backlog. Now, a very nice exercise to actually have your teams create some visual management. And of course, you leave lots of options open for this. So first, the team identifies the key units of work. Of course, what they could do is use their example, the product that they created earlier, the application that they might have created earlier in one of the visioning exercises, or have them use that and say, okay, what kind of work will we actually have to be doing for this product? And then, well, create some visual management. A very nice exercise that you can be doing in 30 minutes to have them think about all the kinds of categories of work that a DevOps team will have to be working on, and have them create a mock-up of the visual management on all the, well, the progress that needs to be monitored for their specific activities. A very fun activity. A little bit on scaling. Some of the things that are important when you start scaling is, of course, that you are not just working as a product owner for your team, but you also have to work together with other product owners and with product management. So those kind of things needs to be taken into account. You see the term PO sync, product owner sync here, which is actually coming from SAFe, from the scaled agile framework. And it's one of those things that you need to start introducing also when you're scaling, finding a way to well, create some kind of small governance between your product owners to have them talking to each other. Pretty important. So what you see here is something that's happening a lot in companies at this moment that deliver bigger products or services with more teams. This is actually something I see happening myself a lot nowadays. Also for companies that have not been working with SAFe or less, but really have their, well, organic way of growth. And you see one product backlog with different sprint backlogs per team. In this example, it's three teams. They have their own product owner. Those product owners will probably report to some kind of chief product owner, maybe a product manager. They have their own Scrum Masters. They also have their own definition of done, but together at a certain moment, they deliver value to the customer. And that value is, of course, built up by the different value created in each and every team. Well, what's also important to say here, of course, is that as a product owner, you also need to be careful that the integration of the different parts of products in these teams will not happen at the end, but it will start on day one, because otherwise they might deliver three pieces of value that will never become one that the customer wants. So again, this also makes the life of a product owner a little bit more difficult than having just a one team Scrum or one team DevOps solution. Now, of course, with something as successful as Scrum and a lot of big organizations working with this, you'll see that there's frameworks popping up. And this is a couple of examples of these frameworks. And what we thought would be a good idea to just go over them a little, well, just in shortly. This is, of course, not a scaled agile training, but I think it's good for product owners to understand the different frameworks a little bit, the differences a little bit, and how they could maybe use some of the things on these aspects. All of these frameworks can actually also be used in a DevOps environment, although if you read the last book, they will probably you'll probably read somewhere that DevOps doesn't exist. But okay, that's their opinion. The next framework is the framework that's closest to, say, Scrum fundamentals. It's, as you can see, created by Scrum.org themselves. And it looks very much like a Scrum framework, but you'll see a couple of things in there. One of the most specific thing to show you that this is about scaling is the Nexus integration team. So there's a specific team that helps all the teams that are together creating a product or creating value, integrating this into a one product or one piece of value increment. If you look at Less, their approach is really that if you start with one team, with one product owner, it's always going to be one product owner. What Less says, and this is really in a nutshell, is that the responsibilities of talking to the customer are more with the team than with the product owner. You will see that in a Less environment, the product owner is also, well, less with the team, more with the stakeholders. So that their approach really is that they create everything from one Scrum team, make it, don't copy and paste Scrum teams next to it, have one product owner with more teams where they are responsible. Well, you know, if you want to know more about this and you want to tell more about this, make sure that you read some of these this material up front, or just show it as an example of what scaling is happening at this moment. SAFe is probably one of the most used and most known scaling frameworks, and they actually tend to do copy-paste Scrum. So if they have a successful team, they copy it. The team still has their own product owner. And what they do is they use the analogy of trains. They actually group teams into value streams, into what they call agile release trains, and start delivering value in this way. It's very well thought out. It can be a little bit overwhelming. A good thing to mention is that as a product owner, you still have your product owner role, and a little bit like the thing we saw earlier on program level, on value stream level, you'll actually see that you work with product managers. And then, of course, there's also the portfolio level. It's a nice framework. It can sometimes be used. It's good to know a little bit more about it. Again, I would suggest. Sorry. If you want to explain this in more detail to your students, make sure that you have read some more material about this upfront. But we really put this in there to just show them some examples. And then the Spotify solution, and well, it's not really a framework. It's actually created also by Henrik Nieberg when he started as an agile coach working for Spotify. He started working with Scrum, but then made some more adjustments on it and made it feel more aligned with the culture at Spotify. And they came up with this solution, which is now also used at some other companies. sometimes successful, sometimes a little bit less successful. But it's a very nice approach. It's still not a framework, but well, again, I would suggest look at some of the in this case, videos on Spotify that will help you explaining it a little bit better to your students. And then what we also did is, what is the difference if you are a product owner in a scaled environment or in a, say, one team environment? And you'll see that there's a couple of differences, but it's not that many. It's really about talking to your colleagues, some extra checks on integration of the Teams products, so those kind of things you'll see in here. And I think this will also be a very nice source for you to discuss with your product owners how different it would be if they would be a product owner in one team or maybe in an environment with, let's say, 100 teams, or in an environment working in a value stream or maybe even an agile release train of 10 teams. Very nice source for a discussion, I think. What changes do you have to make to visual management? Well, that's a very nice thing that you can, of course, also have them do an exercise on. You already did your exercise on visual management. So now, say you assume that the product that they did one of the first exercises on is, well, it's not impossible to build it with one team. You have to do it with maybe three or five. So how are you actually going to change your visual management on that? And then also, make sure that you mention the part of monitoring all the operations work that might have to be done. Because remember, we are now in a DevOps product owner training. So we need to also emphasize on that part. So just come up with some ideas on how they want to approach this, and then have them create some more visual management if the team that they are working on is actually part of a scaling environment. Okay, then another very nice exercise is to have a discussion about the following challenging situations, which will actually pop up one at a time, so you can have the discussion separately. And I would say, tell your students that at this moment they are a product owner, and how would they react on the challenging situation that you are going to show them. So for instance, a CEO comes into your office and says that they want something new now in the middle of a sprint. How are you going to approach this? Or, well, we actually have no time for new development. We did promise a lot of new things to our customer, but there's too many incidents. How do you approach that? The customer wants just a bit more in the sprint. So you gave them some commitment on something, and then in the middle of the sprint, they call you and they say, "But just a bit more." And this kind of customer we all know. They call and say, "Yeah, I do know how Scrum, what Scrum is and what DevOps is. And I do understand that we might be working in sprints, but you know, I really need this little bit more." How are you going to talk to that stakeholder, talk to that customer? And then, of course, the kind of customers that were very used to the traditional way of working and at once long-term delivery commitment, large-scale development, how are you actually going to approach those kind of people, explaining to them that we are now working in a different kind of world and, well, things have been changing? So I think those four situations can be very nice to have discussions with your audience, with your students. And, well, in general, these four might actually will be taking you, well, at least an hour to have a good discussion on it. I would definitely suggest that you take the time to do this. Which actually finishes our last model. Just to finish up anything that we said about the modules, some key takeaways in summary on what we have been discussing. We have been talking about a different kind of product owner in the DevOps environment. And we already knew from the past that the product owner role was already the most challenging, also the most fun and most exciting role in an agile team. What we've seen is that working in a DevOps environment makes it more challenging, but also more exciting, because you have, well, in general, you are just involved with more stakeholders, with more things in business. So it only makes it more interesting and challenging. And of course, more and different stakeholders means also that your stakeholder management will become even more important. Maybe in the past you only had to talk about or talk with one client to which you were going to deliver value. But now suddenly the operations part also comes in. You have to figure out how much time an incident will take and how can I work at my capacity. So those kind of things are extremely important. And not just that, every stakeholder might have that different business value idea. So the way that you look at value will also have to change. And also, well, the way how you create those different types of value towards your stakeholders and customers, well, it's still key, but it will definitely change. So there's a couple of, well, big things that are actually changing for a product owner that used to be in a, say, development environment, or just a Scrum environment, and I was working in a DevOps team. So just tried to put up a couple of very important themes that you will hopefully have seen during this training. Okay, so do we have any final questions?
Looks like we do.
Ah, good.
Yeah. The question that we have here for you is, please explain the relationship of product owner with product manager.
Ah, okay. Well, that's probably not just one explanation. What I can say is, now that we are working more and more in scaled environments, in general, what you see is that a product owner is more of a operational type of professional, really working with Scrum and DevOps teams. And the product manager is more or less the person that takes the strategic decisions on the products and the services. So, works on program level, works together with product owners, and lots of times, and we saw the example earlier on, a what we sometimes call a chief product owner, sort of like the coordinator of all the work that the product owners are doing, is the product manager. So just in general, of course, there can be different situations with different organizations, but that is what I see happening mainly with the customers I work with. So hopefully that answers the question.
Great. That looks like the only question that we had there. So I think we'll go ahead and wrap everything up. Thank you, everybody who was interested in joining today. If you are interested in learning more, or you have any other questions that you didn't want to ask publicly, or just curious or want to talk, that's Eddie's information right there. He's one of the co-developers. I'm sure he'd like to hear any feedback that you may have regarding it, any personal opinions. We want to do everything that we can to make this as a high quality and excellent courseware as possible, and more voices always help to do that. I think that's it for today. Eddie, thank you again for the great presentation.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Yep. Hope everyone has a great day. Bye, everyone.